I would like to now move on to our next speaker, right? The next speaker actually is one of my favorite speakers, Mr. Victor Yaw Asante, who is the Managing Director for FBN Ghana. May I please invite Mr. Victor Yaw Asante, who will be talking about an important topic, which I think is going to be spoken about a lot today. So I wish I could just get on the stage and say, stage is all yours. But yeah, Mr. Asante, the stage is actually all yours. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Let me share. Okay, let me. Yeah. So initially, my CEO from the group was going to be presenting on this, and that's why you see his name, Shola Adedita, CEO of First Bank. He agreed for me to take it for him. So here I am. The next 15 minutes, I'll basically be talking about the future of banking post global pandemic. I'll organize my thoughts in the following four areas: the pre-pandemic banking industry trends, and then also talk about the impact of the global pandemic on the banking industry. And then I will talk about future of banking post-pandemic and the key imperatives for the industry that we find ourselves in. So basically, these are the four pillars around which I'll be organizing the thoughts today's discussion. Now, prior to the global pandemic, the banking industry was already experiencing transformation, as some of you may know, due to some trends across four key domains. One of them is regulations, and regulators were enforcing tighter regulations, and I'm sure most of you have heard about IFRS 9 and so on. That was to insulate banking industry against a crisis or possible collapse. So IFRS 9 was being implemented. One of the things that was also going on significantly was technology and innovation. Most banks were driving towards digital transformation of their processes and systems because everybody was leveraging on technology development. There were a lot of stuff that were coming out. I'm sure some of you may start talking about some of them. We had issues like blockchain, big data, artificial intelligence, cognitive systems, Internet of Things, and so on. So all these things were very active, and therefore this was driving some change, digital change among banks and so on. Customer experience was also evolving, and therefore banks were having to look at these things and make sure we tailor make products and services to meet their expectations at the same level that the customer experience were enjoying in other sectors. Quite a number of sectors had moved ahead of banks in terms of what we're doing, and banks were being forced to look at these things. And then, of course, online IT competition was growing, particularly from the non-traditional players. Fintechs have become very, very big, big techs, fintechs, and so on. And then they were using very simple models and ease of access to basically eat the lunch of banks in quite significant manner. So banks were already looking at change even before the pandemic set in. Now, the pandemic then came in and also now made it even a different proposition entirely. It significantly impacted the banking industry following the very rapid spread of the COVID-19. And there was a lot of instability, both in domestic and global financial markets, as some of you may have experienced. For example, there was increased pressure on revenue and profitability, which was inevitable because economic activity fell. Once economic activity was failing, there's always a direct correlation to the bank's revenue and profitability. So that meant that there was a direct impact in interest earnings, trading income, all manner of fees and so on that banks are accustomed to. And then, unfortunately, whilst this was happening, at the same time, there was a higher operating cost because most costs were fixed, at least in the short term. And whilst the incomes were falling, banks couldn't react at the operating level that quickly. So there was quite a bit of pressure. Now, COVID-19 also led to rating downgrades, especially for developing countries in Africa. And that meant that the higher country risk premium to be paid. And then, of course, it meant that foreign currency access was either very restricted or was very expensive. And then also, we don't talk about potential anymore, but we actually imagine that assets, some assets were affected. There was decline in asset quality because, of course, curtailed economic activities simply meant that people couldn't pay as they had promised. And so that happened, and therefore credit rating downgrades happened to some customers and so on. And all of this meant that the asset quality was dropping for a lot of us. And then operating constraints and vendor support challenges also was a key factor. Keeping employees safe and so on were huge. And I keep saying that one of the very significant things was to wake up one day and realize that your employees were scared. And therefore, that meant that you needed to take immediate action to assuage them, to protect them. So it was not about lip service. People were exposed directly to it. They found some colleagues that were either unwell. In some cases, in our group, we lost one or two and so on. So people were very scared, and therefore you needed to move very quickly in terms of moving out of people and so on. So, and that was also happening to vendors who were supporting banks' IT network and so on. It wasn't just the bank's co-workers, but vendors that we work with. So that was becoming a problem. And inevitably, there were heightened cyber attacks, because, of course, once we needed to use more of our channels and so on, customers were using channels. The work model has changed slightly, where staff had to work from home and so on. So we're opening up our digital platforms, and then we were having to go through all manner of channels, which made it easier for cyber attacks to happen. So there was a dramatic increase in cyber attacks and so on. So this was a scenario that was presented to banks as soon as the pandemic hit the world. We already had issues around migrating to these things. And then all of these issues meant that there was an accelerated need to do something about it. Now, so the post-global pandemic, the future of banking will continue to be shaped by customer expectations, emerging technologies, and the drive for optimal business models. Because, like I said, customers are sports, especially there are some industries that take customer service very quickly in terms of what they're able to do, which now brings pressure to usually traditional approaches like what banks do, which changes a bit different. We also have to drive some different business models to optimize the way we make our business and so on. So customer services, customer expectations have changed. It will continue to shift, and bank will have to adapt with these expectations. We have no other choice but to do that. The technologies, like I said, is also changing very rapidly, which gives lots of advantages to banks and also some disadvantages, of course. The advantages being, for example, we can do 24/7 banking, we can do non-branch banking, and all these are advantages that the banks are taking for emerging technologies. The disadvantage, of course, is that there are all the inherited banking systems and language and platforms that we need to redo. All these are quite expensive and very cumbersome and slow to change. And so you really, really need to quickly adapt some of your systems, embedded and so on. And it's expensive, usage is not assured and so on. So these are all issues that banks need to deal with. But there are definitely advantages that banks can take. We also now have to optimize our business model by adapting the business models to what the operating environment has become. Technology and innovation on organizational business models must, as a matter of fact, be accelerated. And all these three things mean that the banks must shape their business models, and they must shape client expectations by embracing the emerging normal. So our customer attitude and behavior habits evolving us, and what do we mean by demand for superior user experience and personalization? And what will it happen what would that mean for bank work? So bank customer expectations are changing. Everybody's talking about customer centricity, that is putting customers first, putting customers at the center of what we do. First Bank already had a slogan, "You First," and which basically meant that everything we did was around customers. It was way beyond a slogan. It meant that you had to understand what customers want and so on. But that has all dramatically changed because of the new normal. And customers, for example, expect omni-channel capabilities across different channels, so that they want to start transactions from one channel and complete it on another. All of these have implications for our build. And these are the things that we need to change. And that when I speak about old inherited banking systems and so on, these are some of the things we need to sort out, because as far as customers are concerned, they must move from channel to channel seamlessly. Customers also expect instant payments on all transactions without any delay or disruptions. You don't give 1 hour lead time, 30 seconds, 30 minutes lead time, and so on. This time they stand, they do instant, and they want payment to be reflected so that their service will come through. And these are the things they want to do. Okay. Customers also expect digital payments and platform to move. And these are some of the things we need to work on as we sort out our digital payments and platforms. And then they expect tailor-made needs and products for instant satisfaction and so on. So all these are things that we need to work on as banks as we go on. So finally, we also have to talk about the fact that user experience is changing. We know about Generation Z. They are very different in terms of how they expect banks to deliver their banking to them. They are digital savvy, they want mobile phones, digital channels, and so on. And these are things that we need to do. There are generational gaps around some of our customers, and we must make sure we meet all these generations, be it Z, be it Y, be it Z. So these are all issues that banks must look at. And of course, the shift to mobile payments, telcos have moved, and mobile payments have become huge. And all of this means that banks must make sure they are integrating digital wallets and so on bank third parties that are providing all these things must now be embraced for banks to shift to the new normal. Emerging technologies are also have implications for us. There's change in competitive dynamics. We have to combat data, fragmentation of new opportunities. We have to create new similars around industry and so on. Artificial intelligence and machine learning and all these things mean that these are all emerging technologies that banks must focus on and ensure that we sort all of this out whilst we go to the next. And therefore, the future of banking will talk about revenue and productivity improvements. We have to talk about cost containment and efficiency improvements. We have to optimize the bank's risk. All of these things are things that are becoming available to us as we move to the future. So finally, all I need to finally then tell you about what the key imperatives are for banks and the industry. We therefore have to be technology-driven. Our approach must be technology-driven. We must review the business and operating models that we are in by realigning our operating models. For example, the way we approach work has changed. How many hours must somebody spend in the bank or spend at home working? How do we integrate home technology and bank technology and all of that? So we have to review the business model. The future of workforce, these have all manner of implications for us. And this includes even reward and compensation, how we use agile mobility, flexible working hours, integrating digital and human workforce. So these are all things that banks now must focus on as we look to the future. Technology, internal to our customers, internal to our staff, external to our customers, and of course, working with our regulators and our competition to shape the future. So on that note, thank you very much. It's my pleasure presenting to you on what was, what is, and what it will be as we go forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Asante. I really wish, like last time, I could shake your hand, say thank you, go back, click pictures. So we will do that again, hopefully next year or whenever time allows us. Now, it was, if you guys carefully noticed, Mr. Asante was talking about how digitization was already practiced, was already getting to be a norm within Ghana, right? One thing, like Gillian highlighted at the beginning, it is not an option anymore. In fact, Gillian went to the extent to say you either digitize or you die. So it is not an option anymore, right? With that note, I would like to thank you, Mr. Asante, and welcome.